Turn with us to the book of Ephesians, Ephesians chapter 6, and we'd like to read verse 10 through 18. Ephesians chapter 6. Beginning with verse 10, "Finally, my brethren, be strong in the Lord and in the power of His might. Put on the whole armor of God, that you may be able to stand against the wiles of the devil. For we wrestle not against flesh and blood, but against principalities, against powers, against the rulers of the darkness of this world, against spiritual wickedness in high places. Wherefore, take unto you the whole armor of God, that you may be able to withstand in the evil day, and having done all, to stand. Stand therefore, having your loins girt about with truth, and having on the breastplate of righteousness, and your feet shod with the preparation of the gospel of peace. Above all, taking the shield of faith, wherewith ye shall be able to quench all the fiery darts of the wicked. And take the helmet of salvation and the sword of the Spirit, which is the word of God, praying always with all prayer, with supplication in the Spirit, and watching thereunto with all perseverance and supplication for all saints." I want to bring some thoughts this evening entitled, "Standing Strong in the Lord." Now, Paul is warning us here that we are in a war and a great fight, and ought not to take a spiritual 9/11 for us to realize that we are at war. The fight will come to us, so we need to prepare to be strong. 2 Timothy 2. 2 Timothy 2 and verse 1 through 3 says, "Thou therefore, my son, be strong in the grace that is in Christ Jesus. And the things that thou hast heard of me among many witnesses, the same commit thou to faithful men who shall be able to teach others also. Thou therefore endure hardness as a good soldier of Jesus Christ." And so again, be strong in the grace that is in Christ Jesus. And as a good soldier, be prepared to endure hardness. You know, as one of the things, and I have to admit, I have never been in the military. I know secondhand, third hand somewhat of my brother went through boot camp in the Marine Corps. His son, Steve, went through boot camp in the Marine Corps. I have a grandson that has gone through boot camp in the Marine Corps. Others, and I've seen and heard, and I understand that the whole process of the boot camp is to prepare them and get them ready. It's basic training. And a lot of it is conditioning, just physical conditioning, because a soldier in combat will need to be able to endure hardship and difficult times. And so you don't wait until you get into that situation to start getting ready. You prepare ahead of time. They know what it's going to take, and so they try to get you emotionally and physically strengthened up and hardened to be able to endure the hardships and things that you will be called upon to deal with. Spiritually, the same is true. He talks about gird up the loins of your mind. Girding up was something that they would do when they would get ready to go into battle. They would take their long garments and take them and tuck them up into their belt and gird themselves up so that they didn't have anything loose flapping around the legs, and it was the idea of getting ready to go into battle or being able to work, being able to do something. And so it's a preparation. And so that is what our text is talking about here, that we're engaged. There is a battle going on. There is a spiritual warfare going on. And we need to be prepared for it, and we are to be strong in the Lord. He said there in verse 10, be strong in the Lord and in the power of His might. Now, in our text here in Ephesians, I want us to look at three things that Paul gives us here. First of all, there is the admonition to be strong, verse 10. This speaks of us, of our spiritual preparation. Be strong in the Lord and in the power of His might. This is going to require something other than our physical strength. This requires not a physically strong body, but a spiritually strong mind and heart. And so he says, be strong in the Lord and in the power of His might. Jesus Christ our Lord is the Almighty. He has all power, all authority. He said, Matthew 20, all power is given to me in heaven and earth. And so He is the Almighty. He has all power. 1 Corinthians, the 15th chapter, Paul talks about how that all things have been placed under His feet. That is, He's been given authority over all things are placed under Him, and He conquers and subdues all things. 1 Corinthians, the 15th chapter, verse 24 through 28. Then cometh the end, when He shall have delivered up the kingdom to God, even the Father, when He shall have put down all rule and all authority and power, for He must reign till He hath put all enemies under His feet. The last enemy that shall be destroyed is death. For He hath put all things under His feet. Now, when it says He here, is talking about God the Father hath put all things under His feet, or Jesus Christ the Son. But when He saith all things are put under Him, it is manifest He is accepted which did put all things under Him. God the Father did not place Himself under the authority of Jesus Christ the Son, but gave Jesus Christ the Son power and authority over everything else in heaven and in earth. And when all things shall be subdued unto Him, then shall the Son also Himself be subject unto Him that put all things under Him, that God may be all in all. Jesus Christ is going to subdue all things. He is the Almighty. Therefore, when we, as His soldiers, as soldiers of Jesus Christ in the kingdom of God, draw upon His power and His authority and His might, that we might overcome, that we might be able to subdue, that we might be victorious in this battle. And so we are to draw all our strength and power from our Lord Jesus Christ, who has an unlimited supply upon which we can draw. He is our strength. He is our protection and our means to be able to fight, to be able to withstand in the evil day, he says, when the time comes. Now, secondly, Paul sets before us our adversary. Verses 11 and 12, he says, here, put on the whole armor of God that you may be able to stand against the wiles of the devil. For we wrestle not against flesh and blood, but against principalities, against powers, against the rulers of the darkness of this world, against spiritual wickedness in high places. First of all, we see we have an adversary, the devil. The wiles of the devil in 1 Peter 5:8. 1 Peter 5:8, he says, be sober, be vigilant, because your adversary, the devil, as a roaring lion walketh about seeking whom he may devour. Whom resist steadfast in the faith, knowing that the same afflictions are accomplished in your brethren that are in the world. And so we have an adversary, the devil, and some things here that we need to know about our adversary. One, he is wily. Talks about the wiles of the devil. Genesis 3:1 says he is subtle. He was more subtle than all the beasts of the field. And these concepts of wily and subtle, he's sneaky, he's conniving, he's deceitful. Second Corinthians 11:3 speaks of him as beguiling. In 2 Corinthians chapter 11, verse 3, Paul speaking to the church at Corinth says, "But I fear lest by any means, as the serpent beguiled Eve through his subtlety, so your mind should be corrupted from the simplicity that is in Christ." And so we see beguiling through his subtlety. That is his conniving, lying, deceitful way of approaching us. And what we read in 1 Peter, he is stalking you. Our adversary is stalking us as a roaring lion, seeking whom he may devour. And so these are some things that tells us about our adversary, but also we see here in verse 12 that our adversary has some allies. Not just the devil, but principalities, against the powers, against the rulers of the darkness of this world, against spiritual wickedness in high places. And this describes for us that there is a whole host of demons, of various powers and influences. We talk about a hierarchy. These, I believe, are the fallen angels. Lucifer himself was an archangel, and when he rebelled against God, sinned against God, he led a rebellion, and a third of the angels were cast out with him. I believe these are the demons, the fallen angels. They're real. This isn't some fairy story, a boogeyman, they used to call them, to scare little children into being good. You know, if you're not good, the boogeyman's going to get you. No, these are real. And we see the reality of it through the Gospels when Jesus was present and how many times he confronted individuals who were possessed of demons. And those demons, some demons caused them to be deaf or unable to speak. Some had epileptic fits. Some, you know, there was different ones. They afflicted people in different ways. There was the man who was possessed of a legion of demons, and he was wild, and he cut himself, and he lived in the tombs, and he had a supernatural strength. No man could bind him. He'd break loose from the fetters and things like that. And what a difference when Jesus cast the demons out and the people came back and they saw him. He was seated, he was clothed, and he's in his right mind. Yeah. And so demons are real, and the effects that they have on people is real. Now, not every sickness, not every disease is the result of demon possession. But they do exist, they are real, and Jesus dealt with them, and the disciples dealt with it, and they're still in the world today. And that's what he's saying here. Now, this is our battle. This is our adversary, the devil, and his allies, this demonic host. And when we think about these things, and the power that they have and how they can affect our physical lives and our witness and our testimony and different things, it is a fearful thing. It's a very real threat. But we're not to despair or give up in fear. 2 Timothy 1:7, Paul says, "For God has not given us the spirit of fear." He has given us, well, let's turn there. 2 Timothy 1:7. "For God hath not given us the spirit of fear, but of power and of love and of a sound mind," that is disciplined, sober, disciplined, self-disciplined, power, love, and a sound mind. You know, we read there over in Joshua and how he told him, said, "Don't be afraid," he said, "be strong and of good courage." This is what the Lord told Joshua, "Be strong and of good courage." What is Paul saying here? That you may be strong in the Lord and in the power of His might. God told Joshua, "Be strong and of a good courage." Joshua 1:6, Joshua 1:7, "Only be thou strong and very courageous." And verse 9, "Have not I commanded thee? Be strong and of a good courage. Be not afraid, neither be thou dismayed." Because the Lord has not left us defenseless. And see, and that brings us to the third thing that He, our armor and our arms. See, a lot of times the word armor refers, an armorer not only provides like the shield and the breastplate and the armor that we put on, but he also provides the arms, the swords, the weapons that we use. And so that is what Paul gets into here when he describes this, that you may be able to stand. He says, "Wherefore, take unto you the whole armor of God, that you may be able to withstand in the evil day. And having done all, stand." And so, having done all the things that He tells us to do, stand. And be ready to stand in the line of battle. Battles in ancient times, and even up into more recent times, men stood in a line. They fought in formations where they stood in a line, and they had to stand their ground. You know, and that's what he's describing when he's saying stand. You put on your armor, you make all that preparation, and then you stand. And when the enemy attacks, you're able to withstand. And so, "Wherefore, take unto you the whole armor of God, that you may be able to withstand in the evil day, and having done all, to stand." And then the very next sentence is, "Stand therefore," you know. And then he begins to describe our armor. Now, Paul uses a description of the physical armor that a soldier would wear in giving us the spiritual truths, associating them with certain spiritual truths. Our armor is not carnal. That's why he says over in 2 Corinthians chapter 10, verse 4, it said, "For the weapons of our warfare are not carnal." That is, they're not after the flesh. They're not physical. They're not material. It's not a helmet or a breastplate or a shield made out of steel or some substance such as that. But these are spiritual references, he's using that as an example to a correlating spiritual truth, and it is the spiritual that is our armor. Just as he says here, our weapons of our warfare are not carnal, but they are mighty through God. The armor that God has given us, though it is not of steel or wood or spear and sword or things of this nature, yet in the battle that we are engaged in the warfare we're engaged in, they are mighty through God, who is our source, the source of our strength, and the source of our armor. You know, he is our armorer. He's the one who provides these things for us. And he said, we do not war after the flesh. He said, we wrestle not against flesh and blood. Our adversary is not another person. It's not people. I mean, our adversary is not the Democratic Party. Our adversary is not the Russians. Our adversary is not necessarily, though this is closer to the point, an idea, of communism or socialism. But those are other things. Those are more of a political nature. But in a personal spiritual battle, and it does involve ideas, because that's why he said, casting down imaginations and every high thing that exalteth itself against the knowledge of God, and bring into captivity every thought to the obedience of Christ. We are able to pull down satanic strongholds. We're able to take captive imaginations and the people's thoughts and bring them into obedience to Christ. This is our warfare that we are engaged in. And so he describes what is the armor and the arms of the believer. First of all, he says truth. Now, in our text, he talks about having your loins girt about with truth. And so that belt and all that we would put around our middle, the girdle, is truth. And I'm not going to spend so much time on the physical armor that is that he uses to represent the spiritual truth, but I want to look at the spiritual things that make up our spiritual armor. Truth. John 17:17 says, sanctify them through the truth. Thy word is truth. And in John 16:13, it says, howbeit when he, the Spirit of truth, is come, he will guide you into all truth. For he shall not speak of himself, but whatsoever he shall hear, that shall he speak. And he will show you things to come. The Holy Spirit. Truth. And see, this is one of the things. Satan comes against us with lies. He's a deceiver. And so he wants to come at us with lies. He, you know, in the very beginning in the Garden of Eden, when he came to Eve and he, through his subtlety, beguiled her, what was the first thing he said? Hath God said. You know, it causes us to question the Word of God. When he came to Jesus in the wilderness, when Jesus had fasted for 40 days and 40 nights in the wilderness, and he was tempting him to take those stones and turn them into bread, and Jesus answered him from the Word of God, man shall not live by bread alone, but by every word that proceedeth out of the mouth of God. How do we resist Satan? He said, steadfast in the faith. And so, the thing here, we withstand his lies. Our defense against his lies, against his deceit, is the truth. And as a believer, the Holy Spirit dwelling in us, he is our teacher and he will guide us into all truth. And so that is our defense. And so that's how we prepare ourselves. We study the Word of God that we might be able to give answer to everyone that asks us of the hope that is in us through Christ. And so on. Truth. So put on truth. Seek out the truth. Because that is our defense. Righteousness. We have the imputed righteousness of Christ. And so, and we have that understanding. What Paul said in Romans 8, who shall lay any accusation? See, one of the things that our adversary does, he likes to accuse us. He'll accuse us in our own conscience. He'll bring accusations against us and raise people up. It is not the people that is our adversary. It is Satan. Satan wants to distract us and get our attention off of him and on something else. And when we do, when we forget that our adversary is the devil, not the person he may be using, not the person speaking, not the person doing, but our adversary is the one behind those things that is stirring those things up. Our adversary is the devil. You know, and so when we know I have a righteousness that will stand before God because it is the righteousness of His Son, Jesus Christ. And also in addition to that, right, there is a personal righteousness when we are, and this is important that we put on, you know, the new man. We're to put on the new man, which is created in the image of God in true holiness, in which we have a righteousness that we work out in our lives. There's the imputed righteousness, and then there is a practical righteousness that we have. This is the righteousness James was talking about. Said, you show me your faith without works, I'll show you my faith by my works. We're not saved by our works. But a person that is saved will have works. By their fruits ye shall know them. And all the other things that he has said in that line. And he talks about our feet shod with the preparation of the gospel of peace. The gospel. You know, and that's one of the things that he constantly warns us about. If any bring another gospel, you know, the gospel, and knowing how God saved us, and having that salvation and the assurance of salvation that we have in Christ, and to speak that gospel, to share that gospel. The gospel is the power of God unto salvation. And so, this, I believe, is both a scene, and we'll see, too, the Word of God is, too. But the gospel of peace, the preparation of the gospel of peace. When we have peace in our hearts, because we know we have peace with God, and He gives us peace. He gives us a peace that passes understanding. So that's one of the things when standing in that line and confronted by an enemy, to be at peace. You can have turmoil all around you, but to have peace. And I'm not sure exactly how to describe it in terms of a mindset in battle, being centered, being at peace. You know you're saved. You know that God is with you. You know that the victory is the Lord's. It gives you peace. And then he says, faith. The shield of faith. He says, above all, taking the shield of faith. Talk about that this morning. Now abides these three: faith, hope, and love. Faith is one of those three. You know, for by grace are you saved through faith. The just shall live by faith. We are to walk by faith. We're kept by the power of God through faith. by faith. This is where it keeps us from doubting. Satan would seek to cause us to doubt, and doubt would bring about fear, and fear would bring about defeat. Faith, that we might quench the fiery darts of the wicked. All those little snide remarks, all those little hateful, hurtful sayings that they say, the fiery darts of the wicked, let the shield of faith catch them, quench them. Faith, the substance of things hoped for, the evidence of things not seen. And finally says, the helmet of salvation. Salvation. To know that I'm saved, I have eternal life, and I can never lose it. You know, if you're going into battle, what a comfort to know the enemy can't kill you. He can't take your life. I have everlasting life, and Satan cannot take that away from me. If you're saved, you have everlasting life, and Satan, nor all the demons in hell, can take that away from you. That's what Paul said in Romans chapter 8. I'm persuaded there's nothing. There's nothing in heaven, there's nothing in earth, there's nothing beneath the earth, there's nothing in hell that can separate us from the love of God that is given to us in Christ Jesus. And when I have that knowledge and that understanding, that assurance, the helmet, and salvation, I can go into battle with confidence, fearless, knowing that Satan cannot take my life. So those five things are more about our armor, our protection. Those things are there to protect us against the wiles of the devil as we stand in line, as we stand in that battle formation. And there's two things that he gives us, I think, that are more of our offensive weapons. And that's the difference between truth and the sword of the Spirit. The sword is an offensive weapon. Now, it can be used to deflect, to defend, but it is also used to strike. And that is how Jesus stood against the devil when the devil came to him. He used the Word of God. He quoted the Word of God. Satan would misquote it, would misapply it, whatever, would tempt the Lord. And every time Jesus deflected that with the Word, and finally it struck back. And that's what he says, resist the devil steadfast in the faith. We use the Word of God. It is our weapon. The weapons of our warfare are not carnal, but the Word of God is mighty through God to the pulling down of strongholds and so on. The gospel, the word of the good news of how Jesus Christ died for our sins, it is the power of God unto salvation. Our weapons are mighty through God. You see. And when we use the Word of God and we use it correctly and rightly, it is a mighty and a powerful weapon. Now, you see those images of these ancient warriors and a great big old two-handed broadsword. And boy, that is, you know, being swung, that's a mighty weapon. It's a carnal weapon, but that's a mighty weapon. Sometimes you see some of those Vikings, they had those big battle axes and all. Man, I'd hate to try to go up against something like that. That's a mighty weapon. We have a mighty weapon. And it's mightier than those others. It's the Word of God. Now we have And he says it's sharper than, it's quick, it's powerful. It's sharper than any two-edged sword. Hebrews 4:12. And then we have another one. Sometimes we overlook this, but this is a weapon. Prayer. The power of persistent, persevering prayer. Now, that prayer has many functions. You know, supplications, intercessions, and so on. But prayer is a weapon. Sometimes people say, well, I can't do much of anything. All I can do is pray. Well, hey, that is a mighty weapon. James 5:16 says, the effectual, fervent prayer of a righteous man availeth much. Now, it goes back to that righteousness, which is part of our defense. But it also is the ground upon which we can have effectual prayer. God hears our prayers. We regard iniquity in our heart, He does not hear our prayer. We have to get that squared away first. Then He'll hear our prayer. The effectual, fervent prayer of a righteous man, it availeth much. It accomplishes a lot. And so there are times when we are, they talk about, they use the phrase prayer warriors. Well, there's a reason that someone has coined that phrase. And it's very important. And maybe someone can't sing in the choir. That's fine. You know, the Bible doesn't really say it. Well, it does mention choirs and things like that, and those are nice. But I tell you what, I'd rather have a group of prayer warriors any day than a choir. Because as a congregation, we are a choir when we sing praises to the Lord. But anyway, the power of persistent, persevering prayer. When people get together and they pray and they keep on praying and they keep on praying until God answers. There is power in the unity of prayer as well. Matthew 18. Matthew 18. Verse 18 says, verily I say unto you, whatsoever ye shall bind on earth shall be bound in heaven, and whatsoever ye shall loose on earth shall be loosed in heaven. Again I say unto you, that if two of you shall agree on earth as touching anything that they shall ask, it shall be done for them of my Father which is in heaven. For where two or three are gathered together in my name, there am I in the midst of them. And we take verse 20 and we apply it. This is, you know, calling together. It's talking about a church. And the whole context here, if you go back to what went on before, tell it to the church. It's talking about in church capacity. And a lot of times we take that to mean a church can be established with as few as two or three people. And they have authority. The keys of the kingdom of heaven has been given unto them. Whatsoever they bind on earth shall be bound in heaven. Whatsoever they shall loose on earth shall be loosed in heaven. Or more grammatically correct, that which has been bound in heaven is bound on earth, and that which He's already bound in heaven we can bind on earth. And He ties it to the idea of two or more coming together in prayer. When we come together in prayer, we are agreed, and we pray in unity, and we pray with perseverance, and we pray according to the will of God, it availeth much. God says He will hear that prayer, He will answer that prayer, and He will give us that which we ask of Him. Now, that is powerful. If we would just grasp the reality of that and the truth in that and can come together in love and in prayer and be persevering in prayer and being prayer warriors, that is a great weapon. Not everybody necessarily wields the sword in the battle. There are those that support, that keep the sword sharp, that hand the sword to the warrior that wields it in the battle line, and so on. One of the greatest pictures in the Bible, one of those stories, accounts that just captures my mind and imagination and just stuck with me. 1 Samuel chapter 14. There's Jonathan and his armor bearer. Now, in all Israel at this time, as they are subdued by the Philistines took over all the metalworking, blacksmithing, and everything. And so they controlled they didn't have any swords in Israel. And if you wanted a plow, you had to get it from the Philistines. You needed your plow sharpened. You had to take it to the Philistines. They wanted to make sure that nobody had any weapons. So all the metallurgy, the blacksmithing and all was controlled by the Philistines. And I think in the whole army, the whole Israeli army, they only had two swords. Saul had one and his son Jonathan had the other. And Jonathan goes off on his own, him and his armor bearer. 1 Samuel 14, verse 6 and 7. And Jonathan said to the young man that bare his armor, "Come and let us go over unto the garrison of these uncircumcised. It may be that the Lord will work for us, for there is no restraint to the Lord to save by many or by few." And his armor bearer said unto him, "Do all that is in thine heart, turn thee. Behold, I am with thee according to thy heart." So there's two in agreement. Only one of them had a sword. And they're going to go up against a garrison. And this was a garrison that was on a top of a mountain. They had to climb up this little mountain path to get to it. And John says, "The Lord's able to save with a few as well as the many." And the armor bearer says, "Well, whatever your heart wants to do, I'm with you." And the short of the story is then in verse 13, Jonathan climbed up upon his hands and upon his feet, and his armor bearer after him, and they fell before Jonathan, and his armor bearer slew after him. Yeah. See, that armor bearer, he didn't have a sword. He didn't wield a sword. Jonathan had the sword, but his armor bearer was with him. There was a prayer warrior there, if you will. And that's us, you know. There's those that wield the sword and those who follow after him that pray for him. Together, there's no limit to what we as God's people and his church can accomplish. When we put on Christ and the power of his might, and we come together in unity and unite in prayer, we can become an unstoppable force for God. It doesn't make any difference that, you know, he said, "Fear not, little flock." It doesn't make any difference we might be a little congregation compared to some. That's not the issue. I mean, if God can defeat literally, in a physical sense, an entire garrison of Philistine soldiers with one man, a sword, and his armor bearer, think what he could do with this church. And other churches. That's the reason I believe that these Bible conferences and revival meetings and things are so important, and we need to come together and pray, not just for our own services, but for those of these other churches and God's people and his little ones. that God would pour out a spirit of revival upon us, and that that revival would spread through His people, and we'd become an unstoppable force for Him, and we might truly be able to hasten to the coming of our Lord and Savior Jesus Christ. Instead of sitting back waiting for Him, we're running to meet Him. When He comes, when He returns, He'll find us so doing as He left us a commandment to do. And so, Paul said, as he said here to the Ephesians, God says to us to stand strong in the Lord. Standing strong in the Lord. I hope we've said some things that can be an encouragement to you and inspire us together and be an inspiration to others to stand strong for the Lord. Let us stand together. Amen.